two guys are walking through the Pantanal, okay, in the marshlands in the interior of Brazil. And as they're walking along, they see a jaguar following them. And they decide to start running. And as they run, the jaguar starts running after them as well. And after about 5 minutes, one of the guys stops running, and he drops his pack, and he pulls out a pair of running shoes and puts them on. And the second fellow says to him, "Well, why are you putting on the running shoes? Because even with the running shoes, you won't be able to outrun the jaguar." And he said, "I don't have to run faster than the jaguar. I have to run faster than you." You will see the relevance of that as we get into this presentation. Some of you in this room are probably familiar with the work of Mark Tucker, who did a document, edited a document called Tough Choices, Tough Times, in which he talked about the future of the U.S. economy and how routine work was going to be done either by people or machines in other countries, and that what was preserved for the United States was the creative work, research, development, design, marketing and sales, global supply chain management, et cetera, and that was going to be the future for the U.S. This is a delightful piece of fiction, because in fact, that's not what's happening at all. He suggested that the U.S. was secure up in the domain of creative work, and I'm sorry to share with you that that is not the case. Some of you in this room may have, as do I, a Motorola Razr cell phone, in which case this would be a perfect time for you to turn it off, and I will do that as well with mine, because it's always embarrassing when the speaker gets called in the middle of a presentation. Now, I got this phone shortly after it came out, and I live in the U.S., very close to Motorola's Galactic headquarters in Schaumburg, Illinois. And so, naturally, I assumed that this phone was designed there, and in fact, the mechanics of the phone, its size, everything else, was in fact designed there. I also live in Recife, Brazil. In fact, I'm a Brazilian resident. And the area that I live is just a few kilometers away from the old original center of the city in this island. If we have an opportunity to reduce the lights splashing on the screen, that would be terrific. Otherwise, I'll just talk you through what's up there. I don't know if you can see that as well as you might. But on this island, which was always a port, by the way, since the 1500s, it has now become a digital port. It's a place where a lot of startups are taking place, a lot of high-tech enterprises. IBM has offices there, Microsoft has offices there, et cetera, and on this island is the Center for Advanced System Sciences, which is like the media lab at MIT. I was visiting them one day, and sitting in the office of the director, I saw a Motorola Razr cell phone sitting on his desk. And I said, "Oh, how do you like your Razr?" He said, "Oh, I like it a lot." He said, "But I'd better like it." And I said, "Why is that?" He said, "We developed the software for it." And I said, "Oh, I know. This is outsourcing, right? We all know about outsourcing. Motorola came to you to do the software to save money." And as he wiped the tears of laughter from his eyes, he said, "No, they came to us because their engineers in the U.S. could not do it." See, this is part of the presentation that gets so quiet. It always does. Have you noticed this, Bonnie? You've heard this talk like 10 times. It gets quiet just about now. They went around the world to find the best software designers they could. Whether they found them or not, I don't know, but they came here, they chose us. And as for saving money, Motorola's investment in Brazil, $125 million. Okay. That's not saving money. That's spending money. When I flew into the U.S. Night before last, half of the people in business class that I talked with, I do little surveys when I'm on planes, were Motorola employees. I mean, United should change the name to, you know, Motorola Airlines. All right? They're commuting, as do I, back and forth to Brazil. So this is a challenge. This suggests that maybe Mark Tucker didn't get it quite right. Okay? And when we take a look at U.S. engineering graduates over time, this is data from the United States Census Bureau, we see that we did hit a peak in the early 80s, and that we're now at about 63,000 a year, which is fine, excepting that there's 100,000 engineering job offers every year inside the United States. And so, by the way, this includes all graduates of U.S. institutions, including foreign nationals, who are now required to leave the country in most cases, not allowed to stay. And here's something else that's interesting. This was an AP story that came out this March. Northrop has estimated that half of their 122,000 workers will be eligible to retire in the next 5 to 10 years. Interestingly enough, Boeing, 15% of all Boeing's engineers are eligible for retirement right now. Okay, so when you factor that into the fact that we're not generating enough people in the sciences and engineering to fit the existing jobs, and then we've got the baby boomers retiring, that presents a challenge. When we take a look at percentage of college graduates in science and engineering, we find that the United States ranks with Kyrgyzstan. This is a country that's so poor it can't afford to buy a vowel. All right? So, I mean, we've got some real challenges on our plate. We've got real challenges on our plate. By the way, if I offended anybody from Kyrgyzstan, I apologize. But this is a challenge. Now, when we take a look at where growth is happening around the planet, obviously there's continued growth in NAFTA. We know that. But we're seeing a lot happening in the Mercosul countries, which is Brazil, Paraguay, Uruguay, Argentina, Chile, kind of 50% in there, a couple of other countries looking at it, and of course the Southeast Asian nations. But Goldman Sachs draws particular attention to the BRIC countries. BRIC countries is Brazil, Russia, India, China. Goldman Sachs says that's where the future is. So I decided to check them out. Using a tool that I invite you to visit called gapminder.org, you can take the United Nations database and highlight countries and then play a time scale of where they are over time. And in this particular case, we're taking a look at income per capita in international dollars and then phone use per 1,000 people, phone use being a token in place of technology use in general. And if we take a look from 1975 to 2004, we see that the Jaguar is catching up. That's why I told that joke. You see tremendous growth in China. You see similarly tremendous growth in India. Russia, Brazil's growth has been much faster in technology adoption than it has been in GNP, but that's all right. The Russian Federation went through these problems of becoming separated from the Soviet Union and all this kind of stuff. They've now got that kind of resolved, and you see them moving ahead. And the United States is making progress. Let's not deny that. It's important to acknowledge the U.S. is making progress. It's not making progress as fast as some of these other countries. And Goldman Sachs says that in 10 years, unless we make some radical changes, we will not be a dominant economy. We will not be the dominant economy. Interesting. So what can we do as a nation? All right. As you can see, this is a contextual presentation. Today you learned a lot about technologies. Now we're providing a context why these are important things in education. Well, we could increase immigration for high-skilled workers, but don't count on that. And also in the defense industries, you're not going to be able to hire them unless they're U.S. citizens anyway. All right. You could outsource high-skilled jobs to other countries, which means that these folks are getting money from the U.S. and spending their taxes and everything in other countries. That somehow doesn't make long-term sense. Or we could transform K-12 education. That's my personal favorite on this list, okay? So I stacked that slide, all right? We need to grow our own talent. Now, we've been through here before, because on October 4th, 1957, the world changed with the launch of Sputnik. I am a child of the October sky. I was a beneficiary of all the things that happened as a result of Sputnik's launch. And when Eisenhower gave a speech in November of that year, in that speech, he said something really powerful. What he said was that his scientific advisors told him that we needed scientists, we needed engineers, we needed them fast, and that this was a greater challenge than missile development, it was a greater challenge than anything associated with the Cold War. We needed these people, and we needed them now. And as luck would have it, MIT already had a curriculum, high school curriculum, called PSSC, Physical Sciences Study Committee, ready to go. And with Eisenhower's encouragement, that curriculum came into quite a few schools in the US. I was a beneficiary of it, and decided to become an engineer as a direct result of the fact that we made systemic change in our educational system in direct response to Sputnik 50 years ago. All right, we did it. The problem is that the children of the October sky, like myself, are getting ready to retire. And we've got an educational system that seems more focused on getting test scores up than it is on actually preparing people for the world as it exists. And that is a concern that I have. I'm not saying that we shouldn't be able to measure our success, but we need to define what the curriculum is first that meets the needs. If you do the old job better, that's not success if the old job isn't preparing people for the world as it exists. Now, when I was a kid, when Sputnik got launched, I started a scrapbook, and I still have that scrapbook, and it's got all the newspaper clippings and all that kind of stuff. And I saved my money as a bicycle, my bike route delivering newspapers, and I bought a subscription to Popular Electronics magazine. And I started building everything I could. You know, I had soldering iron at that age, and I was just, you know, making all kinds of stuff. I didn't call it STEM, nobody did at that time, but I got deeply involved in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, and we need to kindle that today. We need to do something about it. Now, if you ask people what works in education to help kids develop an appreciation for science, technology, engineering, and math, you read the Rising Above the Gathering Storm document from the National Academies Press. Out of that 591-page document, they only list two things that are known to work. And here's the cliff notes. I just saved you a lot of work. Can I hear a thank you for saving you 500? Okay, you're welcome. Statewide specialty high schools like the Illinois Math and Science Academy, which is a residential public high school for the kids who are excited about these topics, and inquiry-driven project-based learning in any school, these are things that are known to work. They do not represent the core instructional methodologies of our schools, but in the schools that do use them, they work. Now, inquiry is something that all professionals do, and we need to encourage more students to do it as well. So when we're working with teachers around the topic of inquiry, we have to help them learn how to get kids to ask interesting questions, because so much of teaching is seemingly devoted to giving answers whether the kid wants the answer or not. You know, in 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. Okay, thank you very much. Is this going to be on a test? Right? Remember when you were students, did you ever say, is this going to be on the test? Any student who says, is this going to be on a test, is highlighting a flaw in the system. Because if they think the whole reason you're learning something is because it's going to be on a test, we have done a disservice. No, you learn stuff because it's exciting. You learn stuff because it's meaningful in your life. You learn stuff because you're going to actually do something with it. And if we haven't made that clear, that's our fault as an institution. It's our fault as an institution. We need to do that. So we like to suggest that there's a rubric that if a kid goes off and asks a question, it should be tested. Like if a kid asks a question and you say, well, do you already know the answer? And the kid says, yes, well, then that's not a good question. Ask questions to which you don't know the answer. It should have defensible answers. Should open the door to in-depth research and projects. Should be used for anything from a school project to a doctoral thesis. I'll give you a quick example of that in a minute. It should focus on causes, root causes, understandings, not surface facts. It should lead to other interesting questions. And by the way, let's suppose a kid chooses a question and isn't able to find an answer to it. That's okay, because in the process of researching it, they may discover other interesting things. I was at the Xerox Palo Alto Research Center right after getting my PhD. I was their 25th employee. That was the place where the personal computer was invented, the Ethernet was invented, the laser printer was invented. You use it today, we probably had a hand in it in the 1970s, as it relates to desktop technology, okay? Graphical user interface, the whole thing. I was assessed on how many of the questions that I myself asked I was able to answer, because I got paid to answer questions that I myself asked. That's a cool job. How cool is that? if my success rate was over 50%, that hurt my performance review because I wasn't asking tough enough questions. And that just weirds people out. They say, oh, come on. No, that's true. That's what real science is all about. That's what real engineering is all about. Yes, on the critical things, you know, like when you launch something, you'd like to have it go up. But, you know, you also acknowledge that maybe it won't, and you're going to learn something from that so that the next time it will. The successful landing of the Phoenix showed us that it's really important that everybody uses the same measuring system. The successful crash of its precursor, because one group was using metric and the other was using English, showed the flaws of using multiple measuring systems. It was a very expensive way to find that out, but it happened. I had a girl, I was working part-time as a math resource teacher at a small school. A third grade child come to me with her teacher, and the teacher said, I'd like you to work with her because she's bad at math. The third grade, they already knew she was bad at math. She'd never been exposed to mathematics. She'd been exposed to simple number stuff. And let me tell you, mathematicians, how many mathematicians do we have in the room? Raise your hand. Okay, you know what I'm talking about here. You ever go to dinner with some mathematicians and try to divide the bill? Right? Now, you could prove it's divisible. But when it comes to actually getting a number, they're going to pull out calculators fast as anybody else, right? Because mathematicians don't waste their time with that kind of stuff. They think about big issues. Is there a dimensionality of space for which pi is an integer? All right? No, I mean, those kinds of, I happen to enjoy topology, so we'll get into that. We can talk later. Anyway, there's some fascinating things. Well, this girl had never been exposed to mathematics, so I took pattern blocks. Any of you know what pattern blocks are? Okay. They're little geometric wooden blocks, and you've got squares, and you've got triangles, and you've got hexagons, and you've got a couple other shapes, but there are no regular pentagons. So that's five sides with equal sides, equal angles. None of those in the box, okay? And the reason for that is because you can't tile a surface with them, all right? But I thought that was an oversight on the people who make pattern blocks, so I made a whole bunch that were pentagons out of the same wood, stained them a different color, mixed them in. And I had the kids with her in the classroom take them out, divide them into different groups. Okay, triangles here, squares here, pentagons here, hexagons there, cover your tabletop, no gaps. Well, the triangles and the squares and the hexagons got it done, and all the attention focused on the pentagons, which was the table she was at. And she could get three of them together, but then that fourth one didn't fit, and so she's starting to mess around with it. And she said, boy, she said, I can do it, but it's going to take a lot of grout. Okay? And so she said, you know, I'd like to experiment with this some more, because this is a strange kind of mathematics. Three works, four works, six works, five doesn't work. Why is that? That is a question that mathematicians ask. Right? That's a real mathematical question. So I said, how can I help you? She said, do you have any more of these? I said, yeah, I got a bunch of cardboard ones. Take them home. See me next week. The following week, she came back. She glued up on a poster a roughly pentagonal shape that was built out of these pentagons, but still needed a lot of grout. And she said, okay, here's what I'm thinking. If you take this big shape and you squint your eyes so it's kind of fuzzy, and you shrink it down to the size of one of those pentagons, and then you build it again with that and keep shrinking it down, you're still going to need grout, but it's going to be very pretty. Well, she just described something that we call recursive process. And in fact, she had independently discovered a pentagonal gasket. It's mathematically what it's called. Long story short, it was a publishable piece of mathematics at the time she did the work. She could have published this in any math journal. She was in third grade. All right. Last time I saw her was on her first day at Berkeley, UC Berkeley, majoring in mathematics. Now, this shows that you can have kids ask questions that are appropriate for a school project all the way to a doctoral thesis if we get out of their way and give them the freedom to do it with coaching, with guidance. It's not that the teacher doesn't have a role to play, has a huge role to play, and it includes knowing when to shut up and to not prejudice the result by saying, oh, well, that can't be done. Let the kids play with it. Creativity, innovation, these are 21st century skills. We've got to do that. Okay, sorry, I just get into these rants. Now, challenge with inquiry. Can you ask good questions without prior knowledge of the subject area? Of course not. You have to have some prior knowledge, because if you don't have prior knowledge, you can't ask good questions. So let me work with you. This is a good audience. How many of you know what this is a picture of? Can you see it? All right, that's the moon, all right? Here's a question I'll just pose. You might have asked yourself this question yourself. Why is it that we always see the same side of the moon? I mean, isn't that interesting that it rotates at the same speed of the revolution? I mean, it's turning on its axis, but it's turning at the same rate, and so as a result, here on Earth, we only see one side of the moon. There aren't a whole lot of objects that have that characteristic that we know of, but the moon's one of them. That's an interesting question, and that's the kind of question kids can research, and they can go and they can make observations about that. I could also just teach them the answer to the question, but that's not nearly as interesting as letting them go figure it out. Okay, and what do you think is going to be more likely that they will remember, me telling them the answer or them going and researching it themselves? Now that leads to another interesting question though. If we take a look at the backside of the moon and contrast it with the front, it looks completely different. I mean completely different. All these huge, what we call seas, the mares up there, you don't see them on the backside of the moon. Why is that? Well, there was a paper that was just published a month ago that said, we're still not sure, but this is our recent conjecture. The only problem is now we can explain this side, but that means our explanation for the other side doesn't work. Oops. And so scientists are still working on that. They've known about this for a long time. They're still working on it. That's an example of one of those problems that may not be solved in our lifetime. There's a point at which we would tell kids, you know, you might want to just save that one for later and move on to something else. But why we like inquiry and project-based learning in the K-12 environment as it relates to developing STEM skills is because it goes beyond learning about these topics. We teach kids about science. We teach them about these things, but we don't teach them why they're people who spend their lives exploring these subjects. I use chaos theory as a forecasting tool. And when I got married, I got the best of all worlds because I not only got a gorgeous, lovely wife, but I got two beautiful daughters, and my wife got a wonderful son, so I got a twofer out of it. She picks up a boy, I pick up two girls. Hey, it's terrific, right? Our youngest at the time was in high school in the U.S., and one morning she came down to breakfast, and she saw this beautiful fractal on the screen that was a result of a calculation I was doing for someone. And she said, what's that? I said, it's mathematics. And she said, and I'll never forget this, you do math on purpose? And you see, she'd never met a mathematician. She knew how to do mathematics. What she was being taught was mathematics. Never occurred to her that there were people who would do math on purpose. All right? Well, we've got to help our people find the beauty and joy in science, technology, engineering, and math, or we will never address these problems we're talking about. And it's, in some sense, so easy to do in the science domain. Just take the Hubble Space Telescope. And I mean, who can fail to be moved by some of this incredible imagery that's coming out there if it's presented in the right place? I mean, who could fail to be excited about that? In the engineering domain, you know, we all know about multiple processor chips, right? Because we've got, how many of you have dual core processors on your computers and they got quad core out? There's a company, MIT spinoff in California called Tilera, that's got 64 simultaneous processors on the chip. And they're now, this is in production, and now they're going to go to 128. What this means, by the way, is you're talking about a supercomputer chip that'll sit inside your laptop, okay? The battery will be sitting in your car, but the processor, no, actually the power consumption is not too bad on this thing. But this is amazing. It's amazing, this power. And this isn't a research project. This is a shipping, almost shipping product. In India, here's a new car, $2,500 US retail. Imagine the engineering it took to pull that off. Okay? Because this is not an eleemosynary institution. These are not people who are doing this for alms. They're doing this to make money, and they can make money selling a $2,500 car. Only available there. Mathematics, absolutely amazing. I mean, when you take a look, for example, at the ability of iterated function systems to generate lifelike images of things like ferns, now all of a sudden patterns in nature and mathematics start coming together in some beautiful ways. Who could fail to be excited about that in the right context? So we have to provide kids with these opportunities. Now, we think that software and computer tools are very powerful for doing that, but I'm going to give you my little rant on open source software because I happen to be a fan of it. Right now, the big debate is, in many countries, Linux versus Windows, and of course, Vista has been such an absolute turkey that it has accelerated the move towards Linux in some institutions. Some of you are probably aware NASA does a lot of the mission critical stuff is done with Linux because, you know, when you're docking with a space station, the blue screen of death is probably not something you want to see. So reliability is pretty high on their list. And then the open source software in general is very powerful and getting more so. Down in Brazil, we've got a very interesting challenge. Our public educational system, which had been destroyed during the military regime, is now being rebuilt. And the federal government there has decided that technology can be a very powerful educational tool. And so Microsoft came down and said, well, we'd like you to use Windows. The president of Brazil said, well, that's very interesting. At your prices, we would have to export 60 bags of soybeans for every Windows license every year. So you know what? If you leave now, you can still catch that flight back to Redmond. And the following day, he issued a proclamation that all the public sector in Brazil was going to be moving to Linux because he couldn't get the deal he wanted from Microsoft. And so they started this project called Computers for All. And in the first year, 800,000 Linux machines were sold into people's homes without any advertising, just because people go to the, like, Super Target stores, we call Carrefour. It's a French franchise, but same idea. People buy groceries and computers at the same store. Go figure that. It's kind of cool. And these things are selling really well. Why? Because if you're not paying $100 for the Windows license, the price of the machine comes down $100. So that makes it kind of cool. And long story short, by the end of this year, 36 million Brazilian children will be using Linux-based computers in schools. By the end of next year, it's going to be 52 million Brazilian children. Now, in the United States, we are not even at 1 million children using Linux. So Brazil has, you know, gotten aggressive, let's say. In the US, we call this an emerging technology. In Brazil, it's not an emerging technology anymore. Kind of interesting. Now, free open source software, independent of platform, doesn't matter to me if you're running Windows, Macintosh, or Linux. There are wonderful titles that work the same across all those platforms, and they have the benefit, first, of being professional-grade software titles, and secondarily, they're not going to eat into your budgets, because budgets are tight. So we're going to talk about some of these things as they relate to science, technology, engineering, and math. In the science domain, and again, my interest is space exploration. You might have seen the logo up front. I'll tell you about that project a little bit. Celestia. Absolute beautiful program for navigation through the heavens, and you can get plugins for this that give you all kinds of additional features. This is not a NASA project, but NASA people are supporting it with the current imagery and everything else. And if you haven't played with Celestia, highly recommend. I mean, it's a total time sink. You'll just kiss weeks goodbye, but boy, will you have fun. I mean, you can just, it's marvelous. Absolutely marvelous tool for exploring the heavens through a computer desktop. In the technology domain, I think it's important that children learn how to program computers. I believe that very strongly. I mean, you know, we teach children how to read poetry, but we also teach children how to write poetry. Well, we teach children how to use other people's programs. Why don't we teach them how to write programs as well? Doesn't seem to me like it's that hard to grasp the importance of it. The question is, well, what language do we teach? At what age do we start, et cetera? MIT has a wonderful project called Scratch, which allows you to build programs using these building blocks. And the nice thing about Scratch as a programming language is that you end up learning how to build object-oriented structured code that's easy for other people to read, even if you don't know how to write yet. You drag and drop and put stuff together, and the text of your code is on the screen. Those of you sitting close up can see that. And what's nice is there's a button at the top of the screen called Language. If you click on that, you choose another language, for example, Portuguese for Brazil, and it will translate your entire program into Portuguese. So you can work with, you know, people from all over the world, all right, with this. MIT did the version for Windows and Macintosh. You get it from them. I did the Linux version, which is one of the reasons the Linux version is still a little buggy. That's my fault. Okay, I accept that up front. And I'll give you a website later you can download this from. Very powerful, powerful tools. And there are others. You've heard of Alice, maybe, or some other environments that are wonderful for children to learn about structured programming. And then later on, they get into Java, they get into something else when they're ready for it. They've already got good habits of mind that they can bring to them when they get to these other languages. In the engineering domain, there's so many pieces of software out there. We're not going to talk about that right now because they're very specific. But I'm going to talk about creativity, because creativity is very highly associated with engineering. And the Lemelson study at MIT said that 65% of American high school students feel that their creativity is being squished in schools, being absolutely squished out of them. And so we need to do something about that. Well, I told you when I was a kid, I subscribed to Popular Electronics. Today, I subscribe to a magazine called Make. It comes out quarterly. And Make's motto, you can't hack it, you don't own it. So it's basically, you know, how to do stuff with things you already have that you didn't know you could do, and how to build brand new things from scratch. And everything from making the best bottle rocket in the world to making little flashing light things that have magnets on them that you can throw up on magnetic ceilings and they'll stay there till the battery runs out. I mean, this particular issue had an article on how to make a solar-powered xylophone. I mean, these are not necessarily solving humanity's problems, but they are helping kids, or adults for that matter, learn how to be more creative and work with soldering irons and do stuff like that, because that's important. Hands-on, to me, is up to the armpits. We need to encourage that. Every so often, they will publish an article that they say, we really don't recommend you do this, but we want to tell you about it. Most recent one I recall was somebody who had seen the bottle rocket thing and thought to himself, you know, if I was to take about 50 of these things and to strap them on, and the pictures didn't come out too well because the guy who was photographing this was laughing so hard that he couldn't hold the camera still. The author of the piece did talk about the unanticipated pressure of his chin pushing into his neck. It was not very pleasant. And as I say, they did recommend that you do not do this at home. But no danger of that. Interesting magazine. Kids like cartoons. Okay, fine. HowToons page, howtoons.com, and you can download instructions from there on how to make all kinds of powerful stuff. For example, it's raining right now. Well, any self-respecting person knows if you're going to build stuff, you always carry duct tape with you at all times, all right? So if it's raining, what do? Well, you go to a local store, you buy some garbage bags, probably need garbage bags at home anyway, get the 50-gallon kind. For me, I need 75-gallon, all right? And they show you how to make the cuts in this, that you can make a very stylish rain poncho using a little duct tape and a garbage bag. And believe me, this is something you would really enjoy wearing, especially if it's raining hard. How to make, they have their own bottle rockets planned. But the point is, it's about how to build stuff and how to engage kids in that process. And that, to me, is really essential. But you could do other things, too, on the more analytical side of things, using a tool that we call causal mapping. That's different from concept mapping. Causal mapping allows you to build maps of what are the causes, what are the underlying causes that allowed something to happen. So, for example, putting U.S. Man on the moon, why did we do that? Well, the technology was available to do that. Kennedy gave a speech. There was Sputnik. You know, these were things. Why was Kennedy's speech important? Well, it was a national challenge. There was a Cold War going on, all this kind of stuff. The idea is not that I build the map, but that a student would do it. And you keep following this on the technology side. You see there's a low-tech component and Velcro, which is very useful, by the way, up in the space shuttle and certainly in the Apollo mission going to the moon. And where did Velcro come from? It came from a guy walking through a field and seeing all these cockleburrs and thistles stuck to his pants and notice how hard they were to pull out. and said, boy, I bet I could, this is good, this is strong, I bet I could make a fastener out of this. And that's how Velcro got invented. And so because somebody was pulling cocklebirds out of his pants, it allowed us to create a technology that made it possible, among other things, to put a man on the moon. Now, that's not an obvious leap. That's not something you could have anticipated. But a child could figure that out if he just kept saying, why? See? And we have to give kids more opportunities to say why. And then, not just saying why, figure it out. Give them the resources. Figure it out. Mathematics domain. One of my favorite tools from NASA is called MathTrax. This is a program. You type in any algebraic function. It will not only draw the graph, but it will also give you a written description of the graph based on an artificial intelligence engine inside that analyzes the equation and actually gives you a description. And then if you hit play with this parabola here, for example, you'll hear something like, ooh. So you hear the sound of it over time. And I called the guy who developed this, and I said, this is absolutely breathtaking. I've never seen a commercial tool that does this. Why did you do this? He said, well, he said, I'm blind. And I wanted to create math software, graphing software, that blind kids could use. And he said, if you have a text-to-speech reader, all that text can be read out loud to you. And, of course, the audio on the thing lets you hear the sound, the equations. And so now we found that that's very helpful. Totally free software. Teachers love this stuff. Absolutely breathtaking. There will be, there's a professional math title called Maple, which is $495, I believe. And the next version of Maple is going to have this equation to text feature, which is royalty free from NASA, because this is truly open source software, added to it. It's kind of cool. All right. Knowing better than to interfere with receptions, let me start to wrap up. Because it's been a long day, and you guys have been absolutely fantastic and involved in so much stuff, and your head must be exploding. I'm going to tell another story. This one is true, unlike the first one I told. Well, at least I know that this one's true. And it happened to me some years ago. I had really mangled up my arm somehow. And I got to the point where I couldn't raise it higher than this. And so I was required to take some physical therapy to avoid surgery, which was successful. Problem solved. Now, you've heard the phrase, no pain, no gain, right? How many have heard that phrase? Turns out people who do not use that phrase are called physical therapists. All right? And it was amazing through the physical therapy, during which I confessed to numerous war crimes, in conflicts that I had no involvement with, and in fact that had been long over by the time I was even born. I think I sunk the Lusitania and several things. In any event, I was in the dressing room changing, which by the way now constitutes my exercise, because I find that just getting dressed for a workout uses muscles I didn't know I had, and so I said, okay, now it's time to go to the sauna. But in any event, I was in the dressing room sitting between two old guys. Now I'm 65, so I'm talking about fairly aged gentlemen. And one of them was saying to the other, well, how's retirement going? And he said, well, you know, it's interesting that you ask, because I got called out of retirement. And he said, they needed a volcanologist to take a look at this thing. And he said, used to be when I was working, you know, you'd go to the caldera yourself, you'd use your own instruments, but now it's all remote viewing. Well, not having been aware of any volcanic eruptions in Illinois at the time, I said, gentlemen, excuse me for jumping in here, but since you're sitting on either side of me, I couldn't help but overhear this volcano, where is it? And he said, oh, it's on Io. I said, okay, it's on Io. That's a moon of Jupiter, right? Yeah, that's the one. And I thought, the way he was saying it was, yeah, on the way home, I got to stop and get some milk. So I got home, and Norma, my wife, said, how'd it go? I said, follow me. So I went into my office. I went to the NASA site. I downloaded a picture of Io that had just been uploaded. It's from the Galileo mission. And voila, there's a huge volcano. They've since found like 20 more. Absolutely amazing. And what it reminded me of was the story of Rip Van Winkle. How many of you remember that story? For those of you who don't, Rip Van Winkle falls asleep during the colonial period, and he falls asleep when the U.S. is a colony of Great Britain, and when he wakes up, the U.S. is now a democracy. Huge change, because he was asleep for a long time. This made me realize that we have Rip Van Winkle experiences every night. Every night when we go to sleep, we wake up, it's a brand new world. Our children are the ones who need to understand and appreciate and have the resources to navigate and to thrive in that new world. One of the things that we're trying to do to help that along is we've created the Thornburg Center for Space Exploration, which is a middle and high school after school or elective program on STEM skills that focuses on inquiry, focuses on joy, focuses on the kinds of things that we think are going to make a great difference. Not that others aren't doing amazing things, either they are, but we need more projects and more people out there supporting them, because if we don't, as a nation, we have huge challenges we cannot imagine. But I know that we as a nation can also address those challenges. As Kennedy said, the challenges of mankind were created by man and they're solvable by mankind. And I believe that in my heart, and you in this room are the leaders to help make that happen. And it's a delight to be here in your presence. And I thank you so much for your kind attention.